History is a clock that people use to tell their political and cultural time of day. It is also a compass that people use to find themselves on the map of human geography.
Yes, Dr. Clark.
History tells of people where they have been and what they have been,
yes.
Where they are and what they are.
Yes.
Most important, history tells a people where they still must go and what they still must be.
Yes, sir.
The relationship of history to the people is the same as the relationship of a mother to her child.
Yes, sir.
Welcome to the Gilchrist Experience. That's Dr. Clark, our founder of our pride and our history. And he says, like, history is like a mother to the child, and we're the children. And today we have Professor Leonard Jeffries. He's honoring us again, one of his weekly visits. Dr. Jeffries, give us a little background on your experience with Dr. Clark and how that warmed
Well, it would be difficult to give a little background because the relationship with Dr. Clark, myself, and some of his very close partners like Dr. Ben mm-hmm. was very extensive. And but he's such an inspiration for all of us
mm-hmm.
Simply because he really is a self-made man. He's son of a sharecropper.
Right.
Born in Alabama, raised in Georgia,
mm-hmm.
at a time when it was most difficult for African youngsters to get an education, he was able to...
1919.
He was born in 1915.
1915.
Right. Which is a significant date because 1915 represents the triumph of the system of white supremacy globally. Mm. The conquest in Africa, Southern Africa, of the Spanish-American War, conquests, the struggles in World War I, and in terms of ideas and images, that was the period in which the birth of the nation was the most significant movie phenomena at that time in the world. And the birth of the nation used all of this high techniques to tell the story of the book called The Klansman, and mm-hmm. it was the a devastating history of the Civil War victory mm-hmm. being turned around into a victory for the Klan.
Mm-hmm.
And so it really represents the triumph of white supremacy in all dimensions, political, economic, and cultural dimensions. But the seed of the change was planted in youngsters who were born like Dr.
Right.
John Henry Clark.
Right.
And eventually over the next 50, 60, 70 years, and for Dr. Clark it was into the 80s, he became a giant, putting history on its proper course
mm-hmm.
and inspiring whole generations to follow him.
Mm.
And here is a young man growing up, and he used to say that he had three deities in his life growing up. And those three deities were his grandmother, his mother, and his fifth grade school teacher,
uh-huh.
Eveline or Eveline Taylor.
Mm.
But you know, it was hard for him to even get into a library. He had to falsify the name of a white man he worked for
mm-hmm.
to get into a library. But his love of books was such that following the inspiration of Arthur Schomburg, who collected materials mm-hmm. and books, right. and his collection became part of the famous Schomburg collection in Harlem.
135th Street.
But right. Dr. Clark sat at the feet of Schomburg, and Schomburg told him, your history represents the missing pages of world history. And he began to pursue it. At the end of his life, his beautiful wife, now his widow, she was able to send, following his wishes, 20 to 25,000 books that he had collected to Georgia, to the Atlanta University complex that's serving Spelman, the School for the mm-hmm. Women, Morehouse, the School for Black Leadership, Clark Atlanta mm-hmm. Graduate School, and the Interdenominational Theological Seminary.
Mm-hmm.
So that's amazing. that a youngster who was born at the birth of the nation when they were rewriting the history became such a phenomenal transmission of the truth of the history, and then it manifests itself in this enormous collection of 25,000 to 30,000 books. We hope that others will be adding their collections to his collection. I know that Dr. Asa Hilliard, one of our great scholars, his family has considered also complementing the Dr. Clark collection. And I would like to see some of the thousands of books that we have also be a part of that. My wife has a special art collection of books, Dr. Rosalind Jeffries, that would be a complement to what Dr. Clark created. So his reach was enormous. He was a man of the people, but he also was a genius, a self-made genius, who taught those of us who had the PhDs from these high-power schools. But more than that, he reached out across into the Caribbean, into Brazil, into Africa, and bonded with the great scholars there. And then he brought them into our scholar family. So, but he lived in Harlem. He was a man of the community.
Right.
He didn't want to be out of contact with his people. And then most people don't realize he had some military training in the 40s, and he was very successful in managing his military unit and taking care of business. So when
he was a staff sergeant.
Staff sergeant. He showed fellow showed this leadership ability. So in the 40s, he used it after the military to help organize the Harlem History Club and other activities. And then by the 50s, he was getting ready for his major work, which was dealing in the global history of African peoples. By the 60s, he was working with Dr. Ben at Haryu ACT, and then working with another great African from New York, and he, Vincent Harding, Dr. Vincent Harding, and he combined with Dr. Clark to have a sunrise semester. They put in place courses that started 6 or 7 o'clock in the morning, I think it was CBS, and they did their teaching thing. And then the middle 60s, he worked with Malcolm as a part of his brain trust when Malcolm was going global and moving away from the Nation of Islam. And then Malcolm was inspired by what was happening in 1963 in Ethiopia, where the 38 or 40 of the nations, new nations, came together and said that they wanted to form a union. So the Organization of African Unity was birthed in May 25th, 1963, and that was when Malcolm was going through his rapid change and transformation in his global consciousness as an African.
Yeah,
and so
in
that last year or so of his life, he traveled all over the world, and part of it was being inspired by what happened in Ethiopia. So he, with his human rights, African consciousness, revolutionary fervor, organized the Organization of African American Unity to be a complement to the Organization of African Unity. And shortly thereafter, of course in February of 65, he was taken from us. But he had laid down foundations for us linking ourselves globally, and he had the advice of Dr. Clark and Dr. Ben, our great master teacher scholars, as he was mapping out the way forward, which was that we are an African people and we're global. And in each of the African countries where we find ourselves, we should manifest the strength of our history and also link up. And so Dr. Clark went from being the son of a sharecropper to being the inspiration and the brain power and brain trust of some of our greatest peoples.
You know, this is a divergency of what I'm going to say. But you mentioned that Dr. Clark was born in 1915. And that's 50 years post-Civil War, 50 years following the close of the Civil War. And then 50 years later, we have the Voting Rights Act.
65.
We have Selma. We have the Pettus Bridge. All of the things to celebrate the victory over the war 100 years ago, but everything is brought back to a cataclysmic moment in time. And then 50 years later, 2015, we've come another 50 years. And 100 years from the clock's birth.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
50 years from the Civil Rights Act, Voting mm-hmm. Rights Act.
Right.
And looking at where we were 150 years ago and realizing that in spite of the progress, there's been regression in many ways. And the suffering of the people in this year in particular with the killings, the shootings that have been going on, you know, it's just that 50-50. I was just sitting here mm-hmm. thinking about mm-hmm. 50-50-50-50.
Yeah.
Not that it has anything to do so much, but that number 50, those 50-year periods, and here we are, we celebrated the 50th anniversary of the Pettus Bridge earlier this year, and all of the other things that went on 50 years ago. So we are still in a great struggle, regardless of the time.
One of our great leaders mm-hmm. made it clear, and that's a byword that we should be ringing in our hearts and in our minds. Frederick Douglass fought his way out of slavery.
Mm, right.
And he made it clear, and it's a statement that our Sons of Africa used in when we are together, if there is no struggle, there's no progress.
Right.
And so it's not going to be easy. And you're dealing with multiple layers of systems, control and domination, and particularly the global system of white supremacy. And so that we have to continually struggle. And in that struggle, there'll be the gains, and there'll be the retreats, and there'll be the successes, and there'll be the devastation and the defeats. But when you realize this last 100 years, now we're celebrating the 100th years of Dr. Clark, as you mentioned, 1915, now we're in 2015. Yeah. When you go back 150 years, you're talking about black people weren't even considered human.
Right.
They were property.
Right.
They were to be used and abused and worked to death as like animals. So when we say, well, we've been having made progress, yes, we have. I just celebrated last Monday my grandfather's 147th birthday. Mm. He was born in August 10th, 1868. And so 1 foot out of slavery. So his parents, my great-grandfathers, they were enslaved Africans. And for him to be born in 1868, and within 20 or 30 years, they had their families together, they had their institutions together, they had their land. My father, 1914, he was born the last of 13 children. His brother Sam had his farm next door. He had 15 children. The schoolhouse that they built over 100 years ago is there in Georgia. They controlled the education of their children, their land, and they fought off the Klan.
Mm.
He had 50 years to plant his foundation and his seed in my grandmother, which eventually produced my father, 2 years before the Klan murdered him. But he had 50 years to build, and the Klan didn't murder him because he was winking at a white woman. The Klan murder mm-hmm. came because he was the leader of that community. He was the head of the Masonic lodge there, and they burned the Masonic lodge. Eventually, they murdered him. But the family was so productive out of the devastation of slavery and after slavery reconstruction, the rise of the first Klan. And so when things get difficult for me, I say, do you know from whence you came? Mm-hmm. Do you know what your people survived to allow you to get to this point where you are at a pivotal moment affecting intellectual development, education around the world, globally linking up nations and organizations, the global black mayors? I just came from Accra a month or so ago where there's a global alliance of black mayors around the world. Mm-hmm. So you have to put the things in check. In terms of and balances, in terms of what is, how can we weigh these things? And when I realized that the system of white supremacy is still in existence, it is expanding itself, it is now global.
Mm-hmm.
The
mm-hmm.
system of white supremacy has linked up 20, 30, 40 years in the 70s with the Arab emergence and mm-hmm. the oil
okay.
and made them honorary whites.
Right.
And then after Mao Zedong's revolution, last 20 or 30 years, the Asian community, particularly Chinese, have been made honorary whites, and they've joined the global power play. And so African peoples are in a real situation simply because They are the inheritors of the greatest, richest continent in the world.
Amen.
And everybody knows that if there's going to be a future for the global system of white supremacy or the Arab global system or the Chinese and Asian global system, they need Africa. So there's a monumental struggle, no matter what setbacks we have, that we have to engage in to make sure that the foundation people of the human family, the mothers and fathers of the universe, and the richest part of the human condition and environment is managed by people who have a commitment to what we call spirituality and the common sharing of heritage of the worlds. And so we have to understand the defeats that we may have and the setbacks are real. Mm-hmm. But in the context of where we have come from and the where we are going, and in particular, I know that one of our Sons of Africa is here, Brother Reggie, and he's smiling because I developed this concept of the 50-year turning point of history to try to explain all the events that come together and produce a powerful global phenomenon. Mm-hmm. And so we're benefiting from one of the latest 50-year turning points of history, which was 1945 to 1995. And in that period, the world changed. The course of history changed in favor of people of color. Mm-hmm. And you go back. Yes, in other words, and you go back to an earlier 50-year turning point of history, and that's 1492 or 1482 to 1536 AD. And that's when history shifted in favor of the European. The discovery of...
What years were those?
1482, when the Europeans, Portuguese, made a contract with the Africans along the coast of Africa. And that began to develop the gold.
Okay.
And that opened up Africa to this European greed.
Okay.
And then you had 1492, Columbus' so-called discovery.
Right,
but before that, you had the fall of Grenada.
Okay.
And that meant the last stronghold of the African-Arab Moors. In Spain, that so the ship was turning, and Columbus, after the Inquisition in Spain, was trying to find a way to the east.
Mm-hmm.
And so you had all of these so-called discoveries, the victory of white supremacy in Europe, and then you had the Catholic Church putting its blessing on the enslavement of African peoples with the papal bulls, Pope Alexander the Sixth. Pope Alexander the Sixth, in 1493, or thereabout, ruled 1493, 1483, that the Catholics had the right to enslave the infidels.
Ah, okay.
And so, with that combination of contact with Africa, the so-called discovery of the New World, and the blessings of the Pope on enslaving people who weren't Catholic, that set up a 50-year turning point of history in which the European commercial system, commercialism, developed, and that eventually becomes capitalism, and the whole industrial commercial dynamic of slave industries being created. So that put the European on center stage, and to manage this new economics, they needed the nation state.
Mm-hmm.
So the nation state is born at that time. To manage this new economics with this political dynamic, they needed a culture that put them in the context of they are rising. So the culture of white supremacy, everything not white being inferior, it was emerged. So a new intellectual and a spiritual context was created. And so over the time, the Europe, using the triangle slave trade, with out of it comes capitalism. To manage this new economics, you need the nation state. So they develop a type of constitutional monarchy, or in the case of Holland, they developed a capitalist merchant state, which moved around the world. And so nationalism, capitalism, Protestantism eventually emerges. 1517, you have the Protestant Reformation. 1516, you have the Asiento, the contract to take Africans to the New World. And that became a contract, a covenant, that gave power to Europeans, and so they fought wars with each other over who's going to have the contract.
The power.
So that changed our world. Mm-hmm. Africa became devastated with the imposition of these greedy folks who were looking not for a relationship with Africans, but to super exploit it, and who began to impose their values on African peoples and suck in the African leadership into their world of looking for captives. Mm-hmm. So Africans started fighting Africans when Europeans said, we'll give you these guns so you'll have an advantage over this group, and if you come up with some prisoners, we'll have ships waiting for you to take them over to the Nuer. So slavery emerges as a four-way profit system, fitting out the ships and putting in the corporate structures in Europe was the first mm-hmm. stage and the first profit. And this occurred in Spain and Portugal and Lisbon and Oporto, their cities. It occurred in France, in Rouen and Rochelle. New Rochelle is named after that. And Marseille. It occurred in England, in Liverpool, London, and Bristol. It occurred in Amsterdam and Rotterdam. It occurred in Berlin. It occurred in Hamburg, in Germany. It occurred in Copenhagen. All of these Europeans now wanted a piece of this action, and they began to organize their so-called slave trading companies, the model of which was the Dutch East Indian Company in 1601. But when West Africa came in the picture, they created the Dutch West Indian Company in 1621. And that was giving them control of parts of Africa where they could put the trading forts, and then it allowed them to cross the ocean and plant this process in the islands of the Caribbean or North America, and the others followed. The Swedes wanted to be a part of it, so they formed the Swedish company in 16, or the Danish company in 1637, and then mm-hmm. The other Scandinavians said, we want to be a part of it, so they formed the Swedish company in 1649. Eventually, the British company was formed in 1652, and it was renewed in terms of the Royal Africa Company. Mm-hmm. So these are enterprises, capitalist enterprises, that lays the foundation for capitalism, and these institutions also have paramilitary structure. They control fleets, they control armies, and they had a governmental structure so they could take land, divide it up, and sell it. It's an amazing thing to understand that 50-year of history as laying the foundations for the exploitation we have now. But then our 50-year turning point of history, 1945 to 1995, is when the revolutions of our people began to take place. Mm-hmm. 1945, black folks met from all over the black family. They met in Manchester, England. The mm-hmm. Europeans met in San Francisco to put their fractured system back together again. No black folks of any serious consequence was in San Francisco. But that event in the spring and the summer of 45 was countered by the Africans meeting in Manchester in October. Mm-hmm. And they met to plan the struggles for liberation, the struggles for independence, the struggles for new African states. And who was there? The old man, the leader of our consciousness and thinking, W.E.B. Du Bois. Who was there? Okay. Paul Robeson, the great artist and athlete and symbol of struggle. Who was there from the Marcus Garvey's wife was there? Who was there from the Caribbean? George Padmore from Trinidad, Ross McConnon from Guyana. Mm-hmm. In England itself was C.L.R. James. Who was there from Jamaica? Some of our great leaders that eventually, and who was there from the continent? Ezekwe, the father of West African nationalism from Nigeria. Who was there? Jomo Kenyatta, the father of the grandfather of the Mau Mau, who leads the Kenyan revolution. Right. So, and this is the phenomena that occurred when these brothers met and sisters met to map out a way forward, to come up with a plan of action, talk about the resources that were needed. And that's why you had 1945 Manchester, African peoples freeing themselves and laying the foundation for their system. 1946, the Indonesians said to the Dutch, don't come back here. You don't plan to reconstruct your system of exploitation, but you've given us guns to fight the Japanese. We're turning these guns on you. So the Dutch were not. So independence in Indonesia, 46. In India, the independence of India, the jewel of the British crown is gone. 1947, 1948, Palestine, Israel. 1949, the Chinese Revolution. 1952, Gamal Nasser and Naguib, for the first time black men are ruling in Egypt. Mm-hmm. 1953, Mossadegh in Iran. 1954, Dien Bien Phu, the Vietnamese, defeated the French armies in Vietnam. 1955, the African and the Asian new nations got together at the Bandung Conference. Who was there representing Harlem? Adam Clayton Powell. Mm-hmm. 1956, the Sudan is independent. 1957, Ghana is independent. 1958, Guinea is independent. 1959, Cuba independence. 1960, a dozen African nations become independent, including Nigeria and the French-speaking nations. And in 62, 63, it's the West Indies and East Africa. So this and the Mau Mau and all of that, and our movement in the streets and in the South, et cetera, and black power. And this has been such a dynamic. The setbacks we have are real, but what we did in this 50-year turning point of history is unbelievable.
Oh, I thought about South Africa with Mandela Africa. In 90, what was it, 94,
he becomes the president.
Right.
Zimbabwe becomes mm-hmm. independent in the 80s. The Portuguese territory become independent in the 70s. And so our black studies movement and the fight of our students and all of that is a part of this awakening of African peoples. Now, our responsibility is to put together the plan for the future. And that's where the difficulties come in. That's where the ego comes in. That's where COINTELPRO, the system of that we devastated, is now coming back at us. That's why crack. And then now heroin, the prison situation. So we have to be able to put this stuff in serious context. And that's what Dr. Clark told us. Here's this son of a sharecropper,
right,
who one of his great books is Notes, Africans at the Crossroads, Notes for an African World Revolution.
Mm-hmm.
And on the cover are people who were part of this unfinished world revolution. Marcus Garvey, unfinished revolution of Nkrumah, the unfinished revolution of Patrice Lumumba, the unfinished revolution of Malcolm X. And so he outlines that we have moved to throw off the yoke of our oppression. And we've had this revolutionary activity, but he's clearly trying to say that you can have with one arm a revolutionary posture, but you got to have in this other arm building for eternity. And so that's how our organizations emerged, the African Heritage Studies Association that Dr. Clark initiated in 1968-69. And then James Turner, myself, and all of us come together to set up these black studies programs on these white college campuses and also on the black campuses. And then there's so many hundreds of programs that in 1975 we formed the National Council for Black Studies to coordinate these programs. Mm-hmm. And then when Dr. Ben and others started pushing, you can have all this blackness, but if you don't laser beam in the Nile Valley, you miss your power shot. And so Dr. Ben said, we got to go take the Nile. And so here we formed ASCAC, the Association for the Study of Classical African Civilizations, in the 80s. And the idea was emerged thanks to Dr. Ben, 84. We met, had a conference, 500 of us, and said, we got to put something in place. And we did, and we said, we'll incorporate, and we'll meet next year in Chicago. So we incorporated in Chicago. And then they came to New York, the Big Apple, where we put the foundation under them so that this new organization would be able to do something significant. And 86, it was in New York, 87, at my suggestion, I said, let's go to the Nile, and we put in place a pilgrimage, a nation-building African global consciousness process, and we took over 1,000 people to the Nile Valley. It was the most amazing thing. I had 30 people go. My mother went. My nephews, Hakim and Hassan, went. My godchildren went. Gil Noble went. Richard King, and I got him his ticket. I got Gil Noble his ticket. Dr. Clark and Dr. Ben led the way. Milana Kayanga and Jacob Carruthers came along as the key players. Asa Hilliard, the sisters. I mean, that story has not been told. And that's why we've got to deal with. Brother Reggie is here. He, as a young man in 86, he led the Sons of Africa to take Hassan Jeffries, Dr. Clark's son, and Professor Small's son, as preteens. They went as manhood celebration to West Africa with us. And we went to several countries. That next year, after Reggie and others had this experience, they were asked to take on responsibility of leading plane loads of people to Egypt. Reggie was in charge specifically, this is Reggie Majorie now, specifically of 140 plus people on Air Jordan. And they had to go through New York onto a Jordan, and at the airport, the submachine guns and all the rest, and who was the leader? People wanted to know who's the, here's this young man, steps forth, and he was the leader. I was in charge of the Moroccan Air, Royal Air Maroc crew, and that included Regent Sanford and my group, Naeem Akbar, etc. We had another 150. We had seven different airlines to take this 1,000 people, not just to gawk and visit and see, but to claim it, name it, and claim it. And then we were having an international conference, not in Cairo, one of the great cities of the world, but down in Aswan, in the Nubian part of Kemet. And it was such a powerful process that the Egyptian government got worried about what was happening with all of these people coming, linking with the Nubians. And so they tried to put some controls on us. And in fact, the story was that we had 40 buses. Can you imagine 40 buses going to the countryside in Egypt? But in order to coordinate these 40 buses, there are people from Chicago who were into the high technology, said we got to have walkie-talkies in order to connect if a bus broke down, etc. So our powerful technology was messing with the technology that protects the Aswan Dam. And so the Egyptians were calling Washington, what's going on? Where is it? Something is happening with them. So they actually took over the regional government of Aswan and put it under federal control while we were there. Mm-hmm. But they wanted us so much to be a part of this historical process that they roped us off in the Nubian center there. They set up a bank so we could deal with, they set up a market. But people like my mother and Mother Franklin, they weren't going to be stopped. They figured out how to get around the barriers and go into the regular markets. Mm-hmm. And then they realized after a while that we weren't there for revolutionary purposes, revolution of the mind, but not for an overthrow of the Egyptian government. So they loosened up. But just people going as families and scholars shook the world. And that story hasn't been told. But that's been a part of our life. And Dr. Clark was right there. Dr. Ben was right there. Gil Noble filmed it. And so it was so magnificent for Gil. I'm standing on a bluff overlooking the pyramids of Giza. And Gil is filming Asa Hilliard, Dr. Ben, and myself as we talk about the history. And Gil was awed by this. So eventually he went back the following year with Dr. Ben alone and filmed Dr. Ben walking through the Nile, Cairo, the museum, and Aswan, and the pyramids. And it was almost as if Dr. Ben was in his own living room.
Doc, that's the history.
That's why I'm saying whatever setbacks we have, whatever defeats we have, whatever jobs we may have lost, this taking the African mind and imposing it on the world where it should be is what we've achieved. Mm-hmm. And that awakening has created this body of information for the world. You can step into it and empower yourself or step away from it and enfeeble yourself. But that's what Black Studies was all about. That's what the organizations that we created was talking about. That's why people like Gil Noble produced so great achievement, because they plugged into the Dr. Bens, the Dr. Clarks, the Len Jeffries, and our sisters and whatnot. The movements that occurred in terms of the think tanks. Asa Hilliard told us, look, we're up against think tanks. These white folks, rich white folks, are financing think tanks, and then they're paying scholars like Dion Ravitch and Arthur Schlesinger to be their spokesperson. So they said, we need a counter think tank. So we started forming our organization, putting our minds together. Wade Nobles has a think tank out in California. Eventually, Malefi Asante and others developed a program in Philadelphia to create PhD's think tank. And then the Africans came from the continent with the deal, with the real deal. Cheikh Anta Diop said the beginning of a new beginning for us is going to be in the new world. And so he was so glad to come. His ideas were already there, but physically, in 85 he came. He left us in 86. But his ideas were there with Dr. Clark in the 70s. And Professor Ed Howard, who translated his books, Mercer Cook, in the 70s. And then he produced his great work in French, Civilization and Barbarism, and Dr. Clark said, and I'm a French speaker, so I was familiar with his work, and Dr. Clark said, we can't wait 20 years for a translation. Len Jeffries, you're going to have to do something, and I got his message, and within a year or two, in 50 years of teaching at the college, I have never had a sabbatical leave except the 1 year. Dr. Clark said, we've got to have that book translated, and so I went to Geneva, where I had lived for a year and a half in the 59-60. I went back in 83 to translate Diop's book. But it was such a monumental challenge. The first 100 pages deals with Diop challenging the scholarship and the scientific work of the world and showing this is the victory. And I had to get books. I had a whole learning process to deal with the translation and this great mind, Sheikh Anta Diop. He established that there is an African origin of history, not 6,000 years ago with our biblical tradition, going back millions of years. And he put the scientific information there. And then the second 100 pages deals with this emergence of a modern humanity, Homo sapiens sapiens, 200,000 years ago. And so he talks about the two cradles, the cradle of the north that was impacted by the Ice Age and the cradle of the south in the river valleys where civilization and culture had an ecology to emerge and produce a civilization. There's no European involved. And then the last 100 pages is the black African contribution to philosophy and to science. And he outlines that the Greeks sat at the feet of the Africans.
Absolutely.
And got that knowledge and then ran back to Greece and produced a little shadow image of what the great schools of African learning were. They produced their little fraternities and little schools, the Aristotelian school, the school around Plato, the school around Thales, the school around Anaximander. All of them, they didn't look north or they looked south to get their nourishment, to get their mind together, to put in place a philosophy of history. All of that is ours.
If you update us to 2015, we got Jesus White, and
what's the song we play at the funerals? Amazing Grace.
That comes out of the slave system, etc.
But what
you
we
got
have,
a white kid walk into a black church, killing nine people.
Well, not killing nine people. He killed at least six of them were women. I mean, that was the thing that, but that shows the weakness
white
of the
supremacy.
European mind.
We're still
no,
fighting
it
to get
doesn't
rid of
show
the
white supremacy. It shows,
supremacy.
It, that's not white supremacy. That's the fear of the truth. White folks have created in their young people like that fellow, a fear of black folk because the truth cannot be revealed. The truth is we are the mothers and fathers of human civilization. We are the people who laid the foundations for understanding the movement of the heavenly bodies and the relationship of human beings to that. We're the people who laid the math and science
but
comes out of our
know
study.
That.
Yes, because control of the mind
Media.
Is the key, and that's what white supremacy has done very successfully. But I'm saying the victory, we have won the intellectual warfare. We've won it. Now the question is, we know that we, no, the question is, we have to break the chains of the European mindset on our institutions and our people so we can even see that there is a victory won.
Right.
We're still accepting that somebody else built the pyramids. Well, we're doing it. I'm saying we're doing it, but we don't have the resources to do it like we should. Henry Louis Skiff, the Truth Gates, has multi-millions of dollars. He's the richest black scholar in history because he's now taking that history that Dr. Clark, Dr. Ben, Chancellor Williams, John Jackson, all the others have brought forth. He's now reversing it with a twist. He's now dealing with the roots of our family going back, and before we know it, here we attach to some slave owner that's being glamorized. And so he's been paid to be like Clarence Thomas. He's the Clarence Thomas of the academic world to try to twist and turn the history that is incontestable now. Mm-hmm. I've been to Nubia. I've been to the places where he is saying when he got to Nubia, in southern Nubia, around the Sudan, Khartoum and the rest. And he's saying, for the first time, I'm looking at black pharaohs. What the hell are you talking about, Negro? For the first time, you're looking at the 25th dynasty, that Pianke, Shabaka, Taharqa. It was a great moment, but that was the fourth great golden age in our 50-year turning point of history.
Mm-hmm.
The period of Queen Ti and Nefertiti, King Tut and all that. I have a 50-year turning point of history there. And that would be 1400 to 1450. That's when the Africans threw out the invaders, the Hyksos,
mm-hmm.
and established another great golden age. This is the third great golden age in the 1500 BC. There's no Greece, there's no Rome, There's no Moses. Okay, there's no Solomon. And so here is the Ayo, the Africans, restoring this great history. And the women leaders are with the men leaders. Mm-hmm. Ames Nefertari, a symbol of female power, coming from her father. She is one of, that's the family that opened up this great new kingdom. And then another family of leadership emerges after that, and that's the family of Queen Hatshepsut and Thutmose. Mm-hmm. And these great human figures, Thutmose was the great general of the ancient world. He went out of the Nile and conquered those areas around the Nile that were causing difficulties. And then you had so much wealth coming in because of the military achievement of Thutmose III that the next dynasty, the family ruling dynasty, felt that materialism was polluting the spirituality of the Nile Valley. And so that's the
well,
family.
Yeah, we're talking this.
We're talking Queen Ti. We're talking 4900. None of these dates mean anything because it's flexible, but for using these dates that we're talking about.
We're talking about 7,000 years ago.
Well, you're talking about thousands of years ago, but I'm saying 1400 BC, okay. You have a 50-year turning point of history, and that is the Africans that we know. Okay. You know King Tut.
All right.
But let's go back. Let's go to King Tut's brother, Akhenaten, the pharaoh.
Okay.
Let's go back. Let's go to King Tut's grandmother, Queen Ti, and Queen Tai,
okay.
One of the greatest women in the history of the world, ruling with her husband, who ruled 36 years. They ruled together. The Cairo Museum, one of the greatest museums in the world, has a two-story statue of Queen Ti and her husband Amenophis III with equal majesty. Queen Ti was so Nubian that she's written out of history. However, it was Queen Ti who made the arrangements for Nefertiti to come in as a diplomatic marriage from Mytene outside of Egypt to come in to empower the people outside of Egypt with the Egyptian power. She arranged for Nefertiti to come in, but her husband died before he could be one of her lesser wives. So she married him to her son, the pharaoh Akhenaten. And so this great dynasty was so conscious of the materialism corrupting the values and spiritual values of the Nile. So they decided, with Akhenaten, the son, taking the lead of building a new city of God. So they abandoned the greatest city in the world, the city of 100 gates that we called Luxor today.
Luxor,
in the ancient days, it was Thebes. And in the African period of Kemet, it was Waset. They abandoned the city of 100 gates and went out into the desert and built from scratch a new city of God so it wouldn't be tainted by the exploitation of materialism. That Akhenaten revolution was restoring the oneness of God that had been fractured with all of these other philosophical and theological dimensions. That's the history. There's no greater history than that. Nobody can fake it. All they can claim it is these are really white folks in blackface.
Mm-hmm.
They've created this image.
So how does it relate to 2015?
Because we need to know that we come from the greatest human achievement in the world. And if we did it once, like Dr. Clark said, we can do it again. If we understood the truth, and you know a boy king has been raised in the consciousness of the world because of the gold mass that he had. He became king at 14 or 15, and by 19 or so, 20, he was finished. He had a 5-year, 7-year rule. These other people had 30 years, 40 years. Ramsey has 60 years.
They've made all that white.
They've made him a feature because of the gold. Europeans are mesmerized by gold. They got a gold Jones. But what the important thing of that family is, it was a spiritual family. The oneness of God can be attributed to them. The whole concept of commandments and philosophical, the 42 African commandments that are part of the 160, all of that was reduced down to 10. And we focused on the 10, don't know there were 42, don't know that there were 160. The 42 are built into the pillars of the great temple of Waset. 44 pillars in the great center court, 42 of them representing the philosophical concepts that I have not killed, I have not defamed the God, I have followed truth, built into the structure. and two other pillars representing the two capitals, North, Upper and Lower Egypt. So into the architecture, they designed it in such a way that you go into one court and there's an awakening. You go into another court, there's a deep awakening. You go into another court, and then you get into the Holy of Holies, where sacred symbols are. Other people came and said, my God, this is it. Let me get a piece of this. And they got a piece of it and ran back and established their little civilizing process, but they didn't have the spiritual component. They didn't have the female centrality of this. The Greeks took it and created a men-loving men situation. Mm-hmm. The Romans followed the Greeks, men-loving men.
Yeah.
The That's Germans and others today. Followed that.
That's what we have today.
The English followed it. Africans said, if you don't have the woman at the center, if you don't have the women in the key position, then your value system is not complete.
You know,
the African concept, I'm going to leave with this, the African concept of truth is Tahuti, the male figure, writing down the truths so that when you come into the African heaven, it's recorded. But you also have a female feather, a female symbol of truth at Maat, and she's there representing the feather because your heart is weighed against the feather of truth.
Right.
This stuff is so deep and it's there, it ain't hidden, but we're so busy being the worst consumers in the history of the world, buying the garbage that this European world has produced and the Chinese are now producing it. And instead of, we've got to change it. We've got to come up with plans. We've got to.
Well, how come we can't work with Obama?
Well, Obama.
You, Obama, and Sharpton, and the rest of our gallant leaders should be working together. I've got you and Sharpton working together. And, you know, he wants to put up a civil rights museum. I want to combine that.
We don't need a civil rights museum.
Well, that's what
civil rights was an episode in which we were struggling with their system.
Make it a larger issue.
We need a human rights museum.
Okay.
That's what Malcolm was saying.
I'm just trying to get the conversation going.
With the civil rights, you're in the context of the American system of slave owners.
Well, how can Obama help with this
slave owners?
Vision?
Hopefully, when he gets out of the presidency in the next year or so, he'll be free to really say what he understood to be the deal. He is now the president of white America. He's not the president of black America. We don't have
He's
a president.
President of America. America.
Yes, but don't. America is white.
No,
money,
it's not.
The money is
we
white.
We built this country.
Yes.
We have the history.
But we don't know that we built it.
We don't know that we built the White House.
We don't know that we built the Capitol of the United States. We don't know that the symbol that's called the George Washington Monument. We will stand as a million people in front of the George Washington Monument and not claim it.
Claim it as a symbol
of resurrection and rebirth.
I'm arguing with my grandson about the beginnings of Christianity. About Christianity started for him when we came over in the slave ship, the good sheep Jesus in 1610.
Right.
All right, the white man, you know, the Christianity being the white man's religion.
Right.
When the original Jesus was Ethiopian Hebrew.
Well, you have to argue with him.
And look like me.
You have to argue with him, but in the old days, you would take him out in the woodshed, and you would take, you would beat it out of him, and then you'd love him and put it in him, the truth.
I was trying to get him here today.
This is going back to what he's talking about. People not knowing history.
Yeah, well,
and the simple fact, while you were talking about in Holland, you know, how the Dutch got involved.
Right.
It was a period when, you know, following Marco Polo, getting out of the neighborhood and going out into the world, he brought tulips back from India. Tulips have nothing to do with Holland.
Tulips came from
they come from India.
Ah.
And the name tulip, it signifies the turban that the Indians wore.
So they saw this bulb and tied
that to the Indians and they call it tulip. Mm-hmm. But the Dutch were so enamored with these flowers, they stopped growing food.
Mm.
There was a blight that hit the tulip harvest one year. And those people almost died. Their entire economy crashed because they weren't growing flowers. But slavery, thank God, saved a lot of countries. And then when you look back at history, understanding the fallacy of the Roman Catholic Church in talking about the infallibility of the Pope. There is no man walking the earth that's infallible.
That's right.
For you to raise him up just as the ancient raised their monarchs as gods. See, that's where people get turned around when they don't study and they don't look for truth. they get caught up and they drink the Kool-Aid. Pope is not infallible. A pharaoh is not infallible. That's he is not a god. No man is a god.
Right.
So we see that because of the ignorance of people, you can be played.
Mm-hmm. Easily.
And that's everybody is being played across the diameter, across the scale of mankind.
Greed and selfishness, like you spoke about the beginnings in the beginning. But how do we get all this knowledge and from?
Well,
how do we replace 2015, I mean, how do we explain the Charleston 9? What is that, a message?
In other words, it's easy for us to explain the insanity of white folks.
What about our insanity? We're killing each other.
And our insanity can be linked to us being so close to them, integrating so much with them, being educated by
them,
and listening, looking at their TVs and seeing them mess with our music. So we need to come up with some thinking on how to separate ourselves from them in terms of their values, etc. But I'm not worried about the young man who did the killing. But out
Don't
of those,
you?
No, I'm not worried about him because
that's a setup.
But I'm saying it's part of the system. The European system produces death. They kill each other by the tens of millions.
And we're killing each other.
Yeah, but there's no black people killing each other by the tens of millions. When Europeans have their World War I,
the Congo?
And they guess, they're millions, but they're not tens of millions. You know the difference between 3 and 4 million and 40 to 50 million? Do you know what Germany did to Europe and what Europe did to Germany and what they did to Russia and Poland? I'm saying, so this, if we worry about death in the European, we'll be tied up with that all the time. We have to understand life, it comes out of the African experience. We have to breathe new life of the death in the Congo. In fact, the African symbol is from death comes life. That's the symbol of the Tekken called the Washington Monument, that out of death comes life. So we have to understand that. We can't be focused. That young man, if I worried about all these Europeans that did crazy things and all black folks who have a European consciousness doing crazy things, I wouldn't be able to think clearly on what we need to do to put in place our future.
I worry more so than how many blacks are killing blacks.
Well, if you're taught that you
I mean, I don't know why we hate each other so much.
Yes, you do. You're saying that rhetorically. You do. We're trained. We're born to win, and we're programmed to lose.
I'm tired of us blaming the white man.
We're not blaming the white man. We're blaming the white system. And the white system produced World War
I.
When whites were killing each other, gassing each other, and black folks had to be corralled by the millions to help save Europe. That's World War I. Then they went into a depression because they were using their materialistic guys. Then they went into World War II, where tens of millions of them were killing each other again.
But our kids are going the other way.
Yes, but I'm saying,
I mean, look at the music. Look at our black music today.
What about
they cuss and
yes,
they call
don't
their mother
Earth
hoe
angel,
and
Earth angel, will you be mine?
You know what I mean?
Okay, they
my
don't
girl.
Have what's going on.
I mean, we were lovers. So we weren't gangsters.
However,
I mean, how do we learn to be
but
gangsters?
But that's explainable. The European is everywhere where there's money to be made. He's creating gangster rock.
So your message is not getting out there to the people.
Well,
that's why I have you here. They can listen. I wish my grandson was sitting here.
No, but you show him this tape.
You give him the CD.
You show
him the DVD.
You explain to him.
Kevin?
And the thing is, I'm just giving a little tidbit to what has happened. And what we need to do is put this in the home. And it has to be in the hands of the women because they're the first teachers.
Amen.
I am what I am because my mother conceived greatness from my brother and I, and she made my tall 6-foot father understand that and be a part of the process, and she helped mobilize the community.
Yeah.
So in North New Jersey, a poor, hardworking black folk, so of the 100 people I grew up with, 100 youngsters I grew up with, 90 of us made it, and most of us made it big. Why? Because the families were intact. Well, the families worked together. White folks lived around us, but we weren't mesmerized by white folks.
Well, that was a
this is the
genocide
40s and the 50s.
Crack era, the 80s.
That's right.
All right.
So I'm saying that's their system. Death is going to be
that's
the result
the system.
Of their system.
But they gave us crack
so
we could kill each other.
Yes, but
selling each other crack,
but that's not
making
the first.
All this greed and...
But that's
understand
not the first crack.
Your adversary and don't be surprised by your
that's
adversary.
Right.
The kids don't
and
understand it. We
yeah,
are adults.
What are you arguing about?
Here's the thing that our moderator, commentator, et cetera. Systems, brother, right. Systems. I'm not worried about one white boy. I'm worried about the system, the people you do not see, who decide who's going to live, who's going to die.
Well, let me show you this one video of this kid.
Can we just, Julian Bond passed day before yesterday.
Right. Oh, yes. Yes. Go ahead.
We lost Julian Bond.
Passed, and her funeral was Friday.
So we have people who have left indelible imprints in history.
Right.
And most young people today don't even know who Julian Bond
That's right.
was.
That's right.
And he, I should say, is right. in their lifetime.
Right.
Have no clue.
And they neither know anything serious about Malcolm X except a T-shirt. And they don't know anything about Alex Haley. They don't know anything about Dr. Clark. They don't know anything about our great women. So that means we need to use vehicles like you use it to teach our people. But system says that there's going to be death because the white system is, I call it the three Ds, domination, destruction, and death. That's the center of the white system fighting over material things. The Africans devised another system, which I call the three Cs, communal, living together, cooperative, working together, collective, sharing together.
Right.
And the center of that value system is spirituality. That's why we have the leadership of ancient Africans and even modern traditional Africans wrapped into a spirituality. The king or the leader, the Ashanti Hini, Prepe II here, he was an ordinary, talented individual, a member of the Akan family called Ashanti. But when they needed a new king, he had to be wrapped into spirituality. He had to be transformed. He had to go beyond his normal self. When you talk about the pharaohs are not gods. They're a manifestation of God. The pharaoh's ideas and his practices were weighed against the feather of truth just like everybody else.
Okay.
But we've taken this concept, the creator who created the universe, there's no pharaoh who can do anything like that. He can't wave no wand, he can't throw nothing on the floor and it turn into a snake. Right. But he is a part of a divine leadership process. And so he's the spokesperson for the human family. He just doesn't take a wealth unto himself. If he did, he's doing ispet. He's doing evil. And so when his heart is weighed against the feather of the truth, he's not going to inherit. The pharaoh is not going to inherit eternal life if he has not lived a proper life. That ain't God.
Right.
That's someone in the godly process.
Oh, guess what?
What?
Time to go. That's fascinating. It's fascinating.
No, but I mean, I'm glad that you have had the courage to have these type of discussions.
Oh,
and I have to apologize to my brother because Graham would want to participate more. But
no, but I threw that out there.
No,
and your response and only took 40 minutes, but that's great.
No, that's right, because you had your three 50-year periods, and I said, and I know Reggie said,
power to the people.
If Dr. J does not raise his 50 years,
the God in me loves the God in you, and this will continue.
Power to all of our people, even the crazy ones.
Amen.
No, that I threw it out there.